Today, I'm going to inspect and likely replace my brakes on my VANS RV6. I use white electrical tape as an effective gap sealer for the joint between the wheel pant and the leg fairing. My wheel pants are a tight-fitting two-piece unit. Once the bottom piece is removed, the top fairing can be unbolted and lifted off. To remove the brakes, you start by cutting the stainless steel safety wire on the brake caliper. This releases the brake pad on the outside of the rotor, enabling the wheel to be removed if necessary.
There's some wear left on that. Not much though. I replaced the other side, so I'm going to replace this one as well.
Now I'm removing the two nuts that hold the brake caliper assembly in place. This will allow me to pull the caliper back on the lubricated guide pins that align the caliper with the rotor, and ultimately give me access to the inside brake pad. With the caliper removed from the guides, I can remove the inside brake pad.
Yep, time to replace that. I have cleaned up the old brake a little bit in some in just some gasoline, just to show you that there is a little bit of wear left on it. I'm going to replace them. I've got them off. You can see that we're not quite down to the heads of the rivets yet. There's a little bit of space right in there. But I'm going to replace them. They're just about, you can see there's the new one is significantly thicker with respect to the wear area. So I'm going to replace those right now.
Here I'm preparing to drill out the old rivets. I'm selecting a drill bit slightly smaller than the rivet hole to minimize the chance of elongating the rivet hole in the brake caliper. This is not the right thing to do. If you have a threaded brake relining and general rivet tool, you don't need a drill at all to remove rivets. You simply remove the anvil punch and the threaded punch from the frame, and then thread in the removal punch. Align the removal punch to the center of the squeezed rivet that needs to be removed and tighten down. It'll be firm at first, but the rivet will give away and you will have removed the rivet without elongating the rivet hole with a drill. So even though I'm squeezing one rivet at a time, I have the other two rivets in place to ensure the brake pad is aligned properly to the caliper while it is tightened. I'm using a threaded brake relining and general rivet tool. Inexpensive and exactly the right tool for this job. Now, this is more difficult to do on camera than it is off. I'm trying to keep the workpiece visible while I'm doing the work, and therefore it seems a little cumbersome. When the camera isn't running, I just pick up the piece with both hands and quickly squeeze the rivet.
You can see that the kit comes with two different sizes. Yeah, a narrow or a shallow and a long. Here, I've accidentally installed the wrong one. See that one on the end? Get to focus on that. This has to be flush like the middle one. So I have to drill this one out and start again. Okay, I've drilled that out and I have installed it correctly now. So you'll notice on this side here, it is completely flush. See if I can show you there. And on this side here, there's the new brake pad. Here's the one that was removed. Okay, here we have the finished brake pads. This is for the left wheel. Looking pretty good. And here's the parts that were replaced.
Now in a moment I'll have to compress the brake caliper piston, as the new pads are thicker than the worn ones that were removed. While I compress the piston, there is a chance that the excess brake fluid may overflow in the reservoir. So I'm wrapping the brake reservoir with absorbent paper, just in case this happens. Here I'm using a clamp to gently push the caliper piston back to make room for the new brake pads. Mostly you can't see anything as my big hands are in the way. Working on the left wheel here, I just finished repacking the bearing on the wheel, and now I'm greasing up the axle prior to installing the wheel. Notice the wooden block under the axle? That's in case the jack slips. I also added a little grease to the brake caliper slides, being very careful not to get any on the rotor or the brake pads. With the wheel back at 50 psi, I had to raise the jack just a little bit to provide clearance for the inflated wheel. Now I have moved from the left wheel to the right wheel, as when I was reinstalling the inside brake pads, I realized my hands were completely in the way and you couldn't see a thing that I was doing on this video. Here you can clearly see what I'm doing. The brake caliper slides on lubricated guide pins that align the caliper with the rotor. It's always tough getting the first one started.
Am I close?
I love this tool. I should have bought a finger ratchet years ago. It's a recent addition and I use it every day. Here I'm installing the stainless steel safety wire. This will ensure these two critical bolts cannot come loose in flight. Okay, I've moved back to the left wheel to show the installation of the nut that secures the wheel to the axle. A cotter key is used to prevent the nut from unthreading. With the wheel installed and the brake reassembled, time to put the wheel pants back on.
Whew. Wow, is that tight?
I use white electrical tape as an effective gap sealer for the joint between the wheel pant and the leg fairing. Now, the manufacturer recommends the following break-in procedure. Number one, apply brake pressure for high throttle static run-up and note the RPM at creep if you get any. Perform 2 to 3 high-speed taxi snubs to generate 300 to 400 degrees at the brake pads and rotor by accelerating the aircraft to 30 to 40 miles per hour. Remove power and apply firm braking pressure until slowed to about 5 miles per hour and then release pressure. Do not bring the aircraft to a complete stop during the taxi snubs. After accomplishing the snubs, do not drag the brakes. Allow the aircraft to roll as brake free as possible until back to the tie down area. Avoid stopping the aircraft completely as much as possible and then park with the brake pressure off. Allow the brakes to cool 10 to 15 minutes and then repeat step one. There should be a notable increase in the holding torque. I hope you found this useful. Cheers.